Hi, Jen.
Hi, Liz. Good to see you.
Jen, you're head of retail investment banking at Goldman Sachs, and we've seen so far that the pandemic has impacted different retailers in very different ways. Can you give us a sense of the landscape?
Absolutely. It has impacted the retail environment tremendously. I really like to think about it kind of like a barbell effect, in that you've had some real winners in terms of what we call essential retailers, those that have been open during this environment. So the grocery stores, the food retailers, the convenience stores, some of the home improvement players who have naturally seen extraordinary traffic as people are spending all this time in their homes and stocking up their refrigerators and their pantries and realizing those small projects that they've wanted to get done around the house from a home improvement perspective. And then at the other end of the barbell, you have everyone who is closed. And the ones who have been impacted the most significantly have been mall-based apparel companies, department stores, a lot of the casual diner and restaurant peers who have been closed for a very long time. So it's really a case of haves and have-nots in our space today.
So as the economy continues to reopen, how do you expect that picture to develop?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. We're obviously very much in uncharted territory, and you're starting to see retailers that have been closed selectively starting to reopen in different parts of the United States, obviously with a lot of precautions in terms of their employees and for their customers when it comes to sanitation and social distancing and precautions they're taking in the store, whether it's with sanitizing fitting rooms or going to contactless payments. And so there's the in-store version of it. And then the other question is, what happens to traffic? And do customers actually come back and start shopping again in store? Or has the habit of shopping online become so pronounced in this environment that there's just even a continued massive secular shift to e-commerce?
But as you say, even when these stores reopen, it doesn't necessarily mean that customers will come back. What do you think it will take for these retailers to get the type of traffic that they need?
First and foremost is, do customers feel safe going into stores, and how do they view that? And are these precautions enough for them to be comfortable coming back in? And then two is, the products that specific retailers offer, are those things customers want to buy now, or have things shifted pretty materially from a product demand standpoint as well? So a good example is apparel. We've all gone more casual in what we've been wearing around our homes today. And so what happens to more formal, dressier apparel? What happens to cosmetics versus spending on skincare and wellness? And so I think it will be interesting to see how the shift in consumer demand is impacted by products as a result of all this time that we're spending at home.
What about the major retailers that have declared bankruptcy or who are expected to? Are there commonalities between these companies? And what do you think their experience could signal for the industry going forward?
Yeah, it's a great question. We've seen all the headlines recently between J.Crew, Neiman Marcus, Stage Stores having declared bankruptcy, and JCPenney being rumored to file imminently. I think it's interesting to note collectively, those four retailers have more than 2,500 stores and employ close to 120,000 people. So when you think about the impact of retail bankruptcies on our economy, it's quite significant. I think what's common between those retailers is most of them had traditional balance sheet debt. So in addition to their rent commitments to their landlords, they had bank loans and bonds and so forth that, again, given interest payments, as you've seen revenue fall, they weren't able to fulfill those obligations and commitments. What's also common about them is they had been challenged operationally even before this crisis, and it really just accelerated that. In terms of when we think about what happens from here, I think it'll be interesting to see what happens to the rest of the retail landscape, especially those retailers who don't have traditional debt on their balance sheet, but do still have rent payments and lease obligations. And again, if stores are closed or have reduced traffic and they don't have the revenue coming in to help fund those cash flows, how do they pay that rent? And so that'll be the next thing to watch in the coming weeks and months.
So finally, Jen, what sectors of retail and types of consumer behavior will you be paying particularly close attention to in the months ahead?
I think from a sector perspective, you're going to be looking closely at value-focused retailers. Again, as we talked about with a lot of consumers tightening their belts from an economic perspective, those who can serve a value price will be really important. The second will be from a sector and distribution perspective, those who have invested significantly in their digital and e-commerce operations. And whether it's shipping to your home or doing buy online, pick up in store or curbside, but retailers and sectors who have really invested heavily in those alternative distribution versus having to go into the store and interact with an employee or a cashier, that'll be another I think key item of focus going forward. And then, the last is, are you in a need it now sector? Do you sell a product or a service that isn't easily serviceable from an online perspective, or a customer needs it now? You had a part breakdown in your car or a part breakdown in your washing machine and you don't want to wait for Amazon to deliver it. So I think those would be some of the key themes in terms of sectors that'll be winners going forward. I think the other interesting thing to watch is what happens to fitness and wellness as a result of all of this. We've all been spending time at home. We know the importance of exercise on our psyche. What happens though? Are people comfortable going back to a gym or a boutique fitness studio? Or have they gotten used to doing in-home and online workouts, that there's a massive shift from a fitness and wellness perspective? So those will be some of the things that I'll be watching going forward.
Thanks, Jen.
It was great speaking with you today, Liz. Thanks.